Jessica Kingsley Publishers presents Daoist Nei Gong, The Philosophical Art of Change by Damo Mitchell, read for you by Andrew Hunt. Disclaimer. The author and publisher of this material are not responsible in any way whatsoever for any injury that may occur through practicing the exercises outlined in this book. The exercises and practices may be too strenuous or risky for some people, and so you should consult a qualified doctor before attempting anything from this book. It is also advised that you proceed under the guidance of an experienced teacher of the internal arts to avoid injury and confusion. Note that any form of internal exercise is not a replacement for conventional health practices, medicines, or any form of psychotherapy. In your audio library, you will find an accompanying PDF to this audiobook. This includes reference illustrations, tables, and diagrams from the book, should you like to view in detail. This also includes any photos or diagrams related to specific exercise positions mentioned. Figure reference numbers for these are included in the audio for your easy reference. Preface. Since my early childhood, I have been studying the Eastern arts in one form or another. I was fortunate enough to be born into a family of martial artists and seekers of the way. I was exposed to the arts of combat, medicine, and spirituality early enough that their logic and practices began to seep into the deeper layers of my psyche. This practice blossomed into a passion, which often borders on an obsession. Throughout my early and mid-teens, I studied the martial systems and sought to obtain raw physical power. By my late teens and twenties, my interest had been taken over by the path of the internal systems. In particular, the link between practices such as Qigong and meditation caught my interest, and I realized how all of my martial studies had only been laying the foundation for this aspect of the Daoist arts. The result of these studies, which have taken me across Europe and Asia, is the system which I teach within my own school, which is based in the United Kingdom. The foundation of this system is Nei Gong. Nei Gong is the attainment of real internal skill through the practice of the internal arts. It is the awakening of the energy body and cultivation of our consciousness. It is the philosophical art of change which permeates all Daoist practices. In this book, I present the principle and practices of Daoist internal arts. I outline various exercises which may be used as tools to understand Nei Gong. It is my hope that readers will explore the guidelines and practices from this book and see how it fits in with their own practices. Perhaps practitioners will take some aspects of the training only, or recognize elements of the training which they are already studying. This is fine. Nei Gong is not a system of exercises. It is a series of internal changes which a person may go through in order to follow a path to Dao. The way onto the Nei Gong path is through practices like Tai Chi or Qigong. I hope that by the end of the book, readers will be able to understand how Tai Chi and Qigong are only tools to bring about change. Understanding this is the key to understanding Nei Gong. There are many teachers today who seek to adapt exercises to suit modern people. Qigong and Tai Chi were changed to suit the masses, and systems were developed which could be learnt in a much shorter time than their traditional counterparts. This is a positive development, which has enabled the internal arts to flourish and countless people who would otherwise have found these arts inaccessible to experience the benefits they may bring. However, there are many people out there who are frustrated with the situation. They have read accounts of the skills of the past masters and join internal arts classes in order to pursue this path. They are soon disappointed when they find that traditional skills like this require traditional teaching, which is increasingly scarce, either here in the West or in Asia. When putting this book together, I have not shied away from discussing the lengths of time required for understanding each stage of Nigong, nor the inherent risks attached to this kind of training. Whilst practitioners may take some of the health benefits from Nigong with only a moderate amount of practice, true skill can only come to those who train diligently over a long period of time. Some aspects of Nigong training are controversial, in particular some of the skills which can be drawn from these practices. Many practitioners do not believe such skills exist. The Chinese compare this state of mind to being like a frog in a well. The frog cannot see the outside world, and so believes his tiny environment to be all that exists. Like the frog in the well, many practitioners limit their own growth and development through training with a closed mind. This is not the way to Tao. Throughout the book, I have dotted poignant lines from the Tao Te Ching. I did not feel that any attempt to outline traditional Taoist practices would be complete without some words from the original Taoist himself. I myself am a perpetual student of the Tao. I continue to study and develop as well as teach. I hope that this book will serve to help others on their path, or act as a catalyst for their own personal exploration of the Taoist arts. Notes on Romanization of Pinyin. Neigong theory differs a little from Chinese medicine theory, with which an acupuncturist would be familiar. These differences are largely due to different aspects of the energetic system being emphasized in the training. Many of these teachings come from the original guidelines outlined by Lao Tzu and his contemporaries. Where relevant, I have included short sections from the Tao Te Ching, the classical text of Lao Tzu. These sections are from my own translation from the classical Chinese, and so any errors in translation are my fault entirely. Chapter 1. Introduction to Neigong. When President Nixon traveled to China in 1972, he witnessed traditional Chinese medicine being practiced within hospitals and saw how, through the use of acupuncture needles, surgeons were able to carry out operations on fully conscious patients without them feeling pain. Since this time, various Chinese internal arts have been spreading to and becoming popular within the West. One of these arts is Qigong, or energy skill. Qigong is practiced by tens of thousands of people every day in parks, their homes, or even as part of a recommended daily routine prescribed by Western medical practitioners. Through a combination of controlled breathing, slow, gentle movements, and a calm mind, practitioners of Qigong enable their internal energy, Qi, to flow more efficiently through the various internal pathways of the human energy system. This leads to increased health, a stronger immune system, and lower stress levels, amongst other benefits. In the West, Qigong, or the associated art of Tai Chi, and the benefits of these two practices can be felt by anyone willing to look for a local class. What is far less known is another Chinese practice, that of Neigong. In China, there are three main spiritual traditions: Confucianism, Buddhism, and Taoism. These three great philosophies have dictated Chinese culture and their arts for centuries. For the most part, these three traditions have managed to live and flourish alongside each other, and this has resulted in a pooling of methods and philosophies. It is for this reason that it is impossible to say that any of the Chinese arts is born from any one of the three. Qigong, Tai Chi, and Neigong are no exception. Although primarily Taoist in nature, they also have elements of Confucianism and Buddhism contained within them. What is Neigong? Neigong can be translated as internal skill. Defined simply, it is the process by which a person may condition their physical body, cultivate their internal universe, and elevate their consciousness. Nei Gong has long been considered the most advanced and most complete of the internal practices of China. It was kept a closely guarded secret long after Qigong and Tai Chi were leaked to the public of China and the West. Only in recent times have people begun to be aware of the term Nei Gong, and there is still a great deal of confusion as to what it means within the internal arts community. Nei Gong is not a specific set of exercises or movements. Rather, it is a series of stages that a person may move through in their practice, given the correct instruction. In many ways, it is similar to the more advanced processes inherent within Indian yoga, once a practitioner has moved past the basic training of asanas. The Qigong exercises, which are being practiced every day by so many people, serve as the tools for working through this process. Practicing the movements of Qigong on their own will give you good health and mental clarity, but they will not take you any further than this unless you understand the principles of Nei Gong and how to implement them into your training. This book will outline the principles of Nei Gong and give practitioners of Qigong, Tai Chi, and other internal arts a better idea of how these arts fit together and where they can lead. Nei Gong first serves to condition the physical body and then the energy system. These two stages serve to provide the foundation for the third step, which is direct work with the very elements which make up our consciousness. It is important that we keep in mind the three stages of development: physical body, energy body, and consciousness. Each of the three stages in our training requires that we work with and increase our body's ability to produce three substances which we know as Jing, Qi, and Shen within Taoism. They are linked to the three stages of development. Physical body is linked with Jing. Energy body is linked with Qi, and consciousness with Shen. During the practice of Nei Gong, you will go through various changes and stages in your development. The first change you will begin to notice is an improvement in your overall health and well-being. From here, you will begin to notice differences in your personality and outlook on life. The higher stages of training begin to alter the way your mind works and perceives existence. It is at this stage that the Taoist meditative practices of internal alchemy become entwined within Nei Gong. What follows is a brief list of the changes that are most likely to take place within you during the course of your Nei Gong practice. This list was drawn from my own personal experiences as well as from observation of my students over the years. First, your muscles begin to relax and soften. Old tensions begin to release, and the mobility of your joints increases dramatically. After several months' practice, it begins to feel as though you have limbs which are made of jelly. Old injuries begin to vanish. In my case, it was injuries sustained during my martial arts practice which began to slowly fade away. It is surprising to see exactly how much discomfort you have been living with. I often find within my classes that people have unconsciously been living with great amounts of pain, and they only realize when their old injuries begin to fade. Your immune system begins to improve dramatically, and some long-term illnesses begin to vanish. The Nei Gong training at this stage has empowered your body to begin working more efficiently. It begins to seek out and get rid of pathogens and toxins, which most people have stored for many years. Your mind begins to calm down, and for the first time, many people experience what it means to have true stillness for short periods of time within the center of their minds. Stress is not really something we experience during the course of our lives. It is only a product of how we react to outside stimuli. The Nei Gong training has begun to change how we react to outside factors, and so we begin to experience life without becoming stressed by it. Now your bodily alignments begin to change as deeply rooted tensions fade. Many people experience clicks and cracks during their practice as their bones begin to shift into a more natural and correct position. Much like receiving a chiropractic session, people begin to lose even more tension around the joints. As this tension begins to vanish, people literally gain an extra inch or so in height as their bones free up and their joints open. This has the advantage of increasing the efficiency of your body and your physical strength. It always gives me joy as a teacher to see how people's postures improve and the look of relief upon their faces as they begin to straighten up. The energy system begins to awaken, and people begin to experience the more unusual side of Nei Gong training. It is at this point in their study that people begin to experience the movement of their internal energy and how it is linked to their emotions. There are various releases at this stage, and people find that they become emotionally more stable in their daily lives. Later, the body begins to operate on a purely energetic level, and people find that they feel very light. They feel loose and comfortable when they move, and every aspect of their life begins to become fluid and natural. Daoists say that at this point they are returning to Ziran, to nature. The basic levels of Nei Gong training are now complete, and the practitioner can begin to work directly with their Shen. These stages are explained later in the book. For now, it is enough to know some of the benefits which take place during the early stages of practice. Why practice Nei Gong? It is always difficult to answer this question when asked. At first, I was adamant that all people should practice Nei Gong. And much like a door-to-door philosophy peddler, I would try to convince anybody who would engage me in conversation. In many instances, these people would attend one of my classes or courses, but in the vast majority of cases, they would find the training too arduous and so leave after only a few sessions. Although they recognized the benefits of the training, they did not deem these benefits worth the time and effort required. I have since come to realize that people simply move into Nei Gong training when the time is right for them. It is more of a calling than anything else. It just seems that some people are ready to begin bringing about positive changes within the various layers of their being. Many of my students get frustrated at this. They are deeply passionate about their training and desperately want their friends and family to understand. I know that their conviction is born out of compassion. They simply want others to experience the healthy and happy benefits that they have drawn from their practice. But they begin to realize after some time that what I have said is true. People do not move into Nei Gong training through advertising or convincing. They simply come when the time is right for them. I apologize to any readers who are hoping for a better reason to practice Nei Gong, but I cannot give one. If you are not drawn to the practice, then the time is simply not right for you. For those who have begun the training, they have the pleasure of experiencing the Daoist ideals of health, longevity, and clarity of mind. These are truly treasures which enable us to enjoy and get the most out of the rest of our lives. These three alone are reason enough for me. Who should not train? Whilst the internal arts can bring great benefits to those who practice them, it is important to recognize that they are not suitable for everybody. There are some groups of people for whom Nei Gong in particular poses sometimes severe risks. Children and teenagers should not study Nei Gong. Qigong on its own is fine, provided that it is not used to move through the various internal processes of Nei Gong. There should be no direct work with the Dan Tian or any aspect of the energy system. Young people who wish to study Qigong should focus on relaxing and conditioning the body as well as stretching and learning to breathe effectively. usually in China, it is considered better for young people to study the external martial arts, which will prepare them physically for more advanced internal training in the future. The reason for this is fairly simple. Young people and teenagers are subject to a greater amount of emotional disturbances. The teenage years in particular are full of emotional upsets, anguish, and frustration for the majority of young people. The emotional aspect of the heart-mind has not yet fully formed, and it is not until our early 20s that we begin to settle down a little emotionally. The emotional state we settle into may not be a very healthy one in many cases, but at least it should be considerably more stable with fewer swings from high to low. Much Nei Gong work has a direct influence on the emotions and our consciousness. We should not do anything to interfere with the emotions on this level until we have reached a sufficiently stable age. Pregnant women should steer clear of the internal arts. Whilst the risks are low, they are still risks. The internal work can have various effects on the unborn child. An art such as yoga is far more suitable during pregnancy. Those with a history of mental illness should be careful when beginning Nei Gong and seek guidance from an experienced teacher throughout. Any form of work with the mind can be damaging to those with a mental illness if it is not carried out correctly. You should also not train when sick or when in an emotionally heightened state. Wait until your illness is past or you have reached a more stable emotional state prior to beginning practice. The stages of practice. Traditionally, there was no sequential order for moving through the various principles of Nei Gong. This may have been suitable for Chinese students, but in the West, we have a different way of thinking. Society has dictated that we are goal-orientated, and this means we need a process to work through. The order I've put together here is the structure I use to teach my own students. Over the last few years of implementing Nei Gong in my classes, I have found this to be the most effective way of teaching these complex principles to everybody. I will explain the various stages briefly. 1. Conditioning and preparing the physical body. 2. Regulation of the breath and the mind. 3. Beginning the conversion of Jing to Qi. 4. Awakening the energy system. 5. Movement of the Yang Qi. 6. Attainment of internal vibration. 7. Conversion of Qi to Shen. 8. Conversion of Shen to Dao. Conditioning and preparing the physical body. A proper foundation must be built within the physical realm of your body. Here, we must work on our alignments, relaxation, softness, flexibility, and the opening and closing of our joints. We must not neglect this stage if we wish to progress steadily in our training. We must also return to this stage time and time again to ensure that our body remains healthy and is working efficiently. Quite simply, our body is our workshop for Nei Gong practice. If we do not look after our workspace, then we will not produce good results. Regulation of the breath and the mind. We will see later how our breathing and mindset are integral parts of our training. They serve as the intermediaries between our physical body, our energy body, and our consciousness. It is important that we spend time early on in our training working on the condition of our breathing and mindset. Beginning the conversion of Jing to Qi. This is the first stage in our training where we begin to work with the various energetic substances of the body. We are beginning to learn about and refine the internal vibrations which move through us during our practice. This is the point where we are able to begin drawing a strong link between our physical and energetic bodies. If we are not able to make these two systems work efficiently as one unit, then our efforts will amount to little. Awakening the energy system. This stage of training is not as complex as many teachers make it out to be. Once we strip away the flowery language and all of the useless adornments, it is possible to see the root of all of the internal arts. A lot of practitioners never manage to achieve this stage of development for the simple reason that they have not developed a strong foundation in the previous stages. Much of the Daoist teachings concern this stage, but practitioners should be patient in preparing their body and mind for this point in the Nei Gong process. Movement of the Yang Qi. Once we have awakened the energy body, we are able to begin moving the Yang Qi through our system. This is the time of rejuvenation for which Taoism is most well known. The quality of our internal energy is improved and allowed to move freely within us, which in turn nourishes and nurtures the body's tissues. A practitioner who has reached this stage of Nei Gong training is easy to spot, as their body takes on an unnaturally fluid quality that, at the same time, belies a great core strength. Attainment of internal vibration. At this stage, we begin to understand the various substances and functions of the body as vibrational frequencies. We have linked our mind to our internal energy, and we are able to direct our movements with a simple thought. This is a profound step which leads us to be able to understand the nature of our relationship to the outer universe. Conversion of Qi to Shen. We are now ready to begin working on altering the nature of our internal energy so that it nourishes our consciousness. At this stage, we begin to tap into mind-altering levels of comprehension, which followers of all spiritual traditions have strived to reach. This is a high stage of practice, which is accompanied by clear signs of progress. Conversion of Shen to Dao. The final stage of Nei Gong is the conversion of pure consciousness to emptiness. I am afraid that my understanding ends here, as I am working on this stage myself. It is almost certain that your Nei Gong can be taken further, but I only like to talk about things that I have experienced. I only have theoretical teachings on further practice of Nei Gong, but since I have not reached them, I cannot write about them with confidence. Too many times people pass on information which is based on theoretical understanding rather than direct experience. This is how untruths and misinformation are passed on. Philosophy is the root of Nei Gong. The East is rightly famous as the source of many great philosophies. In order for an internal art to be a valid product of the East, it has to adhere to various philosophical roots. It is common for contemporary teachers of the internal arts in both the East and the West to ignore philosophy and focus entirely on the practices which they have been taught. This approach will severely limit the levels of attainment to be had from your practice. Philosophy is the root of all internal arts, and Nei Gong is no exception. How do I understand the origin? Return to the beginning, of course. The core truth of Nei Gong is that after we are born, we begin to grow sick. As soon as we interact with the outside world, we are already moving along the timeline to destruction, which the Taoists simply called our Ming. If we are to attain good health and spiritual liberation, then we have to learn how to reverse this process, known as returning to the source. This travel back to an original state may seem slightly paradoxical to Western minds, but to the ancient Chinese, it was a logical progression. They also believed that the changes which take place within us as we age are a reflection of the processes taking place within the universe around us. And for this reason, they used metaphorical language taken from our external environment to explain what was happening inside us. This was known as the link between the macrocosm and the microcosm. In Taoist thought, The outer environment which surrounds us is the macrocosm. The inside of our bodies is the microcosm. The microcosm relies on the macrocosm for existence, and vice versa. The various energetic shifts which take place within the macrocosm are reflected within the microcosm, and in this way our inner universe is a direct replication of the outer universe. It is important to understand that the microcosm and the macrocosm are only such when compared to each other. Contained within the microcosm are further microcosms, or inner universes, contained within inner universes. To our molecules and atoms, our physical body is actually the macrocosm. If we can understand this principle, then we have built a strong foundation for our study of the nature of the Tao. Our relationship to the outer environment can be further understood by looking at the principle of the three powers within Taoist cosmology. The three powers are the energies of heaven, man, and earth. Heaven is the manifestation of pure, unadulterated yang energy, whilst earth is the physical manifestation of yin energy. The energy of human beings is a combination of these two entities, and we are totally dependent upon heaven and earth for our existence. A major concern of the Taoist arts is reconnecting to these two energies so that we may utilize them for our own ends. This is a completely natural part of our energetic awakening and an important part of the Nei Gong process. I have had students who were scared by the concept of connecting themselves to the energy of heaven and earth, but they have forgotten one of the most important factors when approaching the study of something complex like Nei Gong. You must cut through the flowery language and try to experience exactly what it means. Remember that we are trying to look at the root of the tree and not get distracted by all of its branches and leaves. As human beings, it is often the case that we have forgotten that we are part of the wider cosmos that the Taoists named heaven and earth. As time goes on, we move further and further away from our natural state of being and lose touch with the subtle forces of the planet. How can we as creatures develop spiritually if we have completely forgotten our root? We strive to increase our intellect through science and physical means, but all we do is move further from the truth that lies at the core of our being. We seek happiness through material wealth rather than satisfaction with our connection to the cosmos. This is one of the key factors within both Taoist philosophy and practice. Tao and the Wuji. The Tao is the original creative power of the universe, the primordial chaos from which all existence sprang forth. It is both formless and infinite. According to the teachings of Lao Tzu, its only manifestation within the realm of man is through our consciousness. The Tao contains the inexhaustible potential for all of life, and if we are able to attach our minds to the energy of the Tao, we are able to understand the very nature of existence. This is obviously a very complex concept to grasp, and in order to do so, we must experience the Tao rather than simply learn about it theoretically. The Tao that can be walked is not the eternal path. That which can be named is not the eternal Tao. The vast non-entity of the Tao existed before anything else. It is a combination of the two poles of opposition known simply as yin and yang. Prior to creation, yin and yang were not differentiated. They were merged into a swirling mass of kinetic power, which is usually drawn within Taoist cosmology as a simple, unbroken circle. Another name for this energy is wuji, which simply means without extremities. Wuji is the manner in which the Tao manifests within the spiritual realm of existence. It is an unending mass of information and power which forms the seed for both the energetic and physical realms. The nature of the power known as Wuji is utter stillness, and the information contained within Wuji lays dormant. In Western theory, Wuji could be compared to the point prior to the Big Bang taking place. Within the seat of human consciousness lies this stillness containing dormant information. The state of Wuji sits at the very core of our being and contains the blueprints for every aspect of our physical, mental, and spiritual selves. We call these blueprints our congenital nature. When we are born, our congenital nature shines forth, but as we begin to age and interact with other people, our consciousness becomes distorted, and the congenital nature becomes buried deep within us. The resulting state of being is known as acquired within Taoism. It is this acquired nature that we need to free ourselves from. Only then can we retrieve our original state of being and thus reconnect with Wuji and the Tao. The motive force of creation, Tai Ji. It is an important Taoist concept that stillness cannot exist without movement. When an extreme state of tranquility and calm is reached, there will be born forth a spontaneous and natural form of movement, which the Taoists named Tai Ji. Tai Ji was born forth from the center of Wuji. It manifested as a spiraling energetic wave. This spiraling wave moved outwards from the center of Wuji and began to divide the spiritual power of Wuji into two extremes known as yin and yang. One way to try and understand the nature of Wuji and Taiji is by looking at the two elements in the following way. Wuji contains the potential for existence, but it is simply a blank canvas. Only when the movement of Taiji comes into play is existence projected onto the blank canvas of Wuji. Herein lies one of the most confusing elements of Taoism, and yet at the same time, it is the key to unlocking the nature of our true selves. If Tai Chi serves to provide only a projection of existence, is it real? The Taoist concept is that distortions take place only because of the poles of yin and yang. Tai Chi projects a reality according to yin and yang onto Wuji. And so is it the real world, or is it fake? This is a question which comes up time and time again throughout your Nei Gong and later meditation practice. The answer can only be understood experientially, not intellectually. Whenever there is any energetic shift within the universe, it is due to the power of Taiji, which acts as a catalyst for the processes of change, development, and progress. It is for this reason that we know Taiji as the motive force of creation. In Taoist philosophy, there can be no stillness without movement and vice versa. If a state of complete tranquility and stillness is achieved, then a spontaneous and natural movement will come into being. This is the force of Tai Chi. Yin and Yang. Through the spiraling power of Tai Chi, Yin and Yang were created. These two extremes were originally two parts that combined to form the great Tao. Yin and Yang are well known in traditional Chinese medicine as well as Eastern philosophy, and even people who have never had any contact with Eastern thought are likely to have heard of Yin and Yang, although they will often have an incorrect understanding of them. Yin is often referred to as being dark and feminine, whilst Yang is referred to as being bright and masculine. A better way to understand Yin and Yang is through the extremes of stillness and movement. Yin is normally represented by the color black, or in Yi Jing theory, a broken line. Yang is the color white, or a solid line. If we again look at Wuji as our blank canvas, then yin and yang are the elements which are projected onto it. At this point, though, there are only extremes, nothing in between. Life is obviously not made purely of extremes. There is not just dark and light, there is every possible gradient which can exist between these poles. Everything between absolute light and absolute dark is made up of a combination of the two. There are never any constants between light and dark, only a perpetual shifting between the two extremes. The force that brings about the shift between the two poles is Taiji. When the spiraling energy of Taiji is added to the extremes of yin and yang, we get the symbol we all know. The interchange between yin and yang is manifested within nature as a vibrational frequency. Positive is yang, and negative is yin. These are the peaks and troughs that form the vibration. Everything in the universe, tangible and intangible, is created from various vibrational frequencies. Zoom in close enough with a microscope, and every atom in its smallest part is made up of a vibration. If you look at existence in this way, it is possible to see how yin, yang, and taiji combine to create everything in the universe from emptiness. The various vibrational frequencies of energy that can exist within the energetic realm are represented by the 8 sacred symbols, known as trigrams, or gua. These 8 symbols are outlined in the Yi Jing, I Ching, or Classic of Change. This sacred text contains a mathematical philosophy which explains the various energetic fluctuations within the universe. The 8 gua are made up of a combination of broken and solid lines. A broken line represents yin, and a solid line represents yang. It is not necessary to fully understand the Yi Jing in order to practice Nei Gong. It is enough to understand that they are a combination of yin and yang elements, and that each one shows a different vibrational frequency. You can find the symbols for the sacred gua in the attached PDF. An even distribution of yin and yang creates one of 2 gua. These are kan and li, or water and fire. Every other gua has an uneven distribution of yin and yang, although this cannot really be understood until the vibrational frequency of a gua is looped over and over into a long wave, such with the kan gua. The kan gua, water, has an even distribution of yin and yang when it is combined into a constant vibration. Li, fire, will produce an almost identical wave, with the only difference being the originating energy. An origin of yin will produce kan, whilst an origin of yang will produce li. An origin point of yin is known as kan. The frequencies of kan and li are the prime representations of yin and yang evenly mixing, and so are shown in the symbol for yin and yang, which predates the Taiji symbol. This circular symbol is made up of concentric rings and shows the manifestation of the two energies, which are constructed from an equal proportion of movement and stillness. The central white circle represents emptiness and shows at the heart of movement lies the potential for perfect stillness, or wuji. An image of li and kan constructing yang and yin can be found in the PDF. The Wuxing. The next stage in the process of creation is the emergence of the Wuxing, or 5 elemental processes. These are born from the various interrelations of yin and yang when they are combined with the motive force of Taiji. If yin and yang produce frequency waves, then the Wuxing give those waves direction. The Wuxing are known as fire, earth, metal, water, and wood, and they combine into a cycle of generation and control. One energetic movement can produce another, and in this way they produce a perfect and unbroken cycle. This is reflected within nature by the various processes that take place over time. For example, the seasons, the aging process, etc. These are pure manifestations of the wuxing within the physical world. They bring about the concept of constant change and development, which are the core principles behind Taoism and their arts. Looking at how changing processes are attached to the wuxing, we can see that the wuxing give us change, development, seasons, direction, time, etc. There is an infinite number of categories. These are just a few examples. You can find the full table in your reference PDF. Categorization according to wuxing. Summer is the fire season. Late summer is the earth season. South is the fire direction. Center is the earth direction. Hot is the fire climate. Damp is the earth climate. Excitation is the fire emotion. Worry is the earth emotion. Red is the fire color. Yellow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.